Another case in Rule 32, in case of token or a voucher or a coupon or a stamp other than postage stamps, which is redeemable against supply of goods or services or both. Say a discount coupon you have received for any purchases that you made in a mall, then what will be the value of supply? Money value of goods or services or both redeemable against such token or voucher or coupon or stamp, say Sodexo vouchers you have received. So after redeeming these vouchers, you got grocery or goods worth rupees say 5000. So the value of supply will be 5000. It is that simple, that logical. Say a value of voucher for free movie ticket. You got a voucher, you got some discount on some online purchases, some debit card swiping or credit card swiping, that you got a free voucher for free movie ticket. So what is the value of that movie ticket? Say it is 500 rupees. Then the value of voucher at the time of redeeming it will be 500 rupees. Another case under Rule 32, services in relation to purchase or sale of foreign currency. So the dealers of foreign currency, foreign exchange, how they will calculate the value of supply? They are having the option for this Rule 32. There is one option, option A, buying rate and selling rate, the difference as per RBI reference rate multiplied by currency units. If the reference rate is not available, 1% of gross Indian rupee value of the transaction. We will take example so that this law will be clear. And where the conversion is not in Indian rupees, say you must have taken say euros and converted in dinars or dirhams or say USDs, so it is not converted into INR, then 1% of lesser of the Indian rupee equivalent of each currency exchange. We will see one example so it will be more clear. If this option is not availed, then there is another option, is a simple one. Gross amount up to rupees 1 lakh 1% or minimum rupees 250 will be his value of services. From 1 lakh rupees to 10 lakh rupees, 1000 plus 0.5%, and after 10 lakh rupees, 5500 plus 0.1%, maximum 60,000. So as per these slabs, on the gross amount of his service charges, he will pay GST. Option B, once exercised, cannot be withdrawn during a financial year. So these money exchangers can either opt option A or option B during a financial year. In between, they cannot change. So let us take one by one how the calculation is done for this valuation. Option A, first part was buying rate or selling rate minus RBI reference rate multiplied by currency units. Say for example, one currency is converted, one US dollar, 100 US dollars are converted into 64,000 rupees at the rate of 64 per USD. And RBI reference rate was for US dollar 1 was 63 per US dollar. So as per this formula, the value of supply in this case will be 63 is the RBI reference rate and buying or selling rate is 64, so the difference is 1 rupee, multiplied by number of currency units, 100, $100 you have exchanged, that is equal to 100. And the GST will be levied on 100 rupees in this way. And in case if the references is not available, 1% of gross Indian rupee value of the transaction. So if the RBI reference rate is not available, then 1% of what is the Indian value? 6400 in rupees. So 64 rupees will be the value of service in this case. So it is simple, RBI reference rate and actual rate of conversion multiplied, the difference multiplied by number of units of currency. And if RBI reference rate is not available, then 1% of equivalent Indian rupees. That was in first case. Second case, where the conversion is not into Indian rupees, it means foreign currency is converted into some different foreign currency, not in Indian rupees, then 1% of lesser of Indian rupee equivalent of each of the currency exchange. Let us take an example. Say US dollars, 9000 US dollars were converted into 4500 euros, 4500 K pounds. Now see, this US dollars are not converted into Indian rupees, they are converted into UK pounds. RBI reference rate at that time for US dollar is 63 per US dollar, and for UK it is 82 per pound. In this case, neither of the currencies are exchanged in Indian rupees. So what is the calculation logic? Take 1% of lesser of Indian equivalent for each of the currency. So let us calculate 1% of US dollars. If they were converted into Indian rupees, then what would have been the value? 9000 US dollars multiplied by 63, that is equal to 5,67,000. And UK pounds, if converted, it would have been 4500 into 82, that is 3,69,000. So what is the lesser of these two? Lesser amount is 3,69,000. So value of taxable service is equal to 1% of lesser of these two rupee equivalents. 1% of 3,69,000, that is 3,690. 3,690 will be the value of service in this case. Option B. In option B, if option A is not applied, then you can opt for option B. In option B, slab wise rate is given up to 1 lakh, 1 lakh to 10 lakh and above 10 lakh. What is the rate? Let us say exchange 10,000 US dollars to Indian rupees at the rate of 64 per USD. And the dealer is not going for option 1. So what he will do is, under option B, value of currency exchange in Indian rupees is 64 multiplied by 10,000 US dollars, that is 6,40,000. So this 6,40,000 he will put in these slabs. So up to 1 lakh rupees, that is first, it is 1% or minimum 250. So up to 1 lakh, 1% of 1 lakh comes to 1000. So minimum was 250, 1000 will be charged. Then next one, from 1 lakh to 10 lakh, 1000 plus 0.5%. So for that extra 5,40,000, because see, out of 6,40,000, we have calculated 1 lakh first. So for remaining 5 lakh, he will apply 0.5%, that is equal to 2700. So 2700 plus 1000 initially calculated, that will be 3700 will be value of supply in the second case if he is opting for option B. Now we will discuss a very important concept under rule 33, supply of services by pure agent. Over here you have to just remember that this is supply of services only. So this rule is not applicable in case of supply of goods. It is only for supply of services that pure agent is provided. Now what is the pure agent and what all this theme is? Let us try to understand. See, sometimes what happens is, say Mr. A is working on behalf of Mr. B. He is providing some service to Mr. B, and for providing him service, he has to work, he has to represent him as an agent. So he may incur some cost and then he will get this reimbursed from Mr. A. So whether that reimbursement of expenses will also be added in his billing for GST purpose, in the value of supply for GST purpose, that is covered under this rule. So let us see who will be treated as pure agent. The expenditure or cost incurred by a supplier as a pure agent of recipient shall be excluded from the value of supply if all the following conditions are satisfied. So a person will be treated as a pure agent and he is incurring expenses on behalf of supplier if and only if all the following conditions are fulfilled. What are the conditions? Let us take one by one. He enters into an agreement with recipient as his pure agent to incur his expenses and cost in the course of supply of goods or services or both. So there is a specific agreement that, okay, I will incur cost on behalf of you. He neither intends to hold or not holds any title to the goods or services that he procures. Now, what is the meaning of title to the goods or services? It means he is not becoming a titular owner on the bill or on the invoice. His name is not appearing. The name of his supplier, the name of the person for whom he is procuring the goods or services will appear. He does not use for his own interest such goods or services procured. So he will not use for his own interest, but he is purchasing on behalf of his customer. He receives only actual amount incurred to produce such goods or services. So on one hand, he is purchasing goods, saying, look, I am purchasing these goods for you. He is purchasing for 100 rupees, but while charging, he charge extra to his customer, something more. So that is not allowed. That is not covered under the pure agent clause. Then he makes payment to third party on authorization by such recipient. It means on behalf of recipient, he is purchasing goods. He is making also payment on behalf of his recipient. Then such payment is separately indicated in invoice issued. So when he make the payment, he will recover it from his customer. And in the invoice, he will show it separately that my charges is so and so, I have paid on your behalf so and so. So in this way, you have to separately show in the invoice. The supplies procured are in addition to the services he supplied on his account. So the basic services plus other supplies, these are separately identifiable. So let us take one example so that it will be clear in which cases services provided by a pure agent are considered for Rule 33. Let us take an example that A is engaged to handle a legal work pertaining to incorporation of company B. So B has appointed a company secretary or chartered accountant for incorporation of the company. Other than their services, A also recovers from B registration fees paid to registrar of companies. Now let us make some assumptions in this case that A is acting as an agent, obviously, of B Limited. So he may go to the registrar of company, he will make payment of some fees, some stamp duty, registration fees, etc. on behalf of B Limited, and this all is been authorized to do so by B Limited, obviously. So what the final bill or invoice of A Limited will consist of is, see, my professional charges are rupees so and so, plus following are the expenses incurred on behalf of B Limited, registration charges, fees, traveling expenses, XYZ amount, etc., etc. So whether GST is to be paid on these other expenses which A has incurred on behalf of B, that is the question. Rule 33 covers supply of services by a pure agent. Mr. A is working as a pure agent or not, that we have to decide. So let us check with one by one clauses. Clause 1 was, A enters into an agreement with the recipient as his pure agent to incur expenses or cost of supply of goods on behalf of him. So obviously A and B Limited or B company has agreed, you incur the cost on my behalf. So the first clause is, let us say, compile it. Second, he neither intends nor holds any title to the goods or services or both procured or supplied. Now, in our example, what Mr. A is procuring on behalf of B? Mr. A is taking on behalf of B the registration fees, or he is incurring the expense of registration fees. So whether he is having any title of the goods or services for that, on the receipt for registration fees, whose name will appear? Mr. A or B Limited? Obviously, it will be of B Limited. So that services, he is not holding any title for the services. So in this case, second condition is also fulfilled by A. Now let us check the third condition. He does not use for his own interest such goods or services so procured, whether that registration fee paid is for the benefit of A or for B Limited, his client. It is for B Limited. So he is not using these services for his own interest. So the third condition over here is also fulfilled. Check now the fourth condition. He receives only the actual amount incurred to procure such goods or services. Now let us assume that A has paid rupees 1000 as registration fees and he charged B the same amount of 1000 rupees along with that particular receipt. So in this case, the third condition is also fulfilled. But if A has incurred 1000 rupees and he is charging B 1200, then he is not acting as a pure agent. He is charging 20 rupees extra that will be chargeable for GST. Next condition, he makes payment to third party on authorization by such recipient. Obviously, on behalf of A, only on approval of B, A is making the payment for registration fees. So the next condition is also fulfilled. And such payment is separately indicated in the invoice issued by him. So when finally A prepares invoice, he shows that my consultancy charges are rupees 10,000 plus 1000 rupees amount paid for registration fee to the registrar of companies on your behalf. Let us say if this kind of a declaration or this kind of a separate indication is also there in the invoice. And finally, the supplies procured are in addition to the services supplied on his own account. So this registration fee paid is additional facility, additional service that Mr. A, or additional convenience I will say, A is providing to B Limited for registration. So all the conditions are fulfilled. It means A is working as a pure agent. So what is the outcome of this then finally? So ultimately, whatever expenses A has incurred on behalf of B Limited as a pure agent will not be taxable. So in the bill of A, only the consultancy charges will be the value of supply. On that amount only he will pay GST, not on registration fees paid to registrar. He will not pay any GST on that.